far-sketched improv show. Okay, well, there's one tonight at 9 p.m. in Daniel Recital Hall. 9:30. Someone just yelled out at me. So either way, if you come, you'll have fun. Tomorrow night, there's an event called Ghost of Christmas Past. This is going to be from 8 to 9:30 in Daniel Recital Hall. This is tomorrow night. It's going to be a couple of us from the ministry houses, the houses in general, Stringer and the townhomes sharing our testimonies. So you guys should definitely come on out and see that. And then Saturday night from 8 to 10 p.m., there's a lip sync battle, which is one of the biggest events of the year. And funny story about that, last year, my dreams came true. I did Can You Feel the Love Tonight, Lion King. And we had a whole team. I did this huge choreography, this big dance. I was on someone's shoulders. I mean, I literally, this was it for me. Like, if the world ended afterwards, I was okay with it. So I ended up winning like $75 in gift cards. This year, there's an even bigger prize. It's like $500, I think. But last year, I took home the $75 in gift cards, and I was so excited because it was to the movies, and I love the movies, and I lost them. Yeah. So I felt like this year I probably shouldn't participate because I am not responsible enough to possibly win that. So you guys should come. It's going to be awesome. I'm going. It's going to be such a fun time. I wish I could participate, but like I said, I'm just not responsible enough. So anyways, I hope you guys have a great Christmas break. Today we have Sharie King and Clayton King from Clayton King Ministries. They're going to be talking to us about just what it looks like to take home the kingdom of God to our homes for Christmas, for the holidays. So if you guys will, just be super respectful and really tune in to what they have to say to you, because I know it's going to be awesome. If you will, stand with us and worship.
Sing this with us. If my heart is overwhelmed and I cannot hear your voice, I'll hold on to what is true, though I cannot see. If the storms of life they come and the road ahead gets steep, I will lift these hands in faith, and I will believe. And I remind myself of all that you've done, and the life I have because of your Son. Sing this out, love came down. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours, I am forever yours. Mountain high and valley low, I see out, remind my soul that I am yours, I am forever yours. My heart is filled with hope, promise comes my way. When I feel your hands of grace rest upon me, staying desperate for you, God, staying humbled at your feet, I will lift these hands and pray. Oh, I will believe. And I remind myself of all that you've done, and the life I have because of your Son. Love came down and rescued me. Love came down and set me free. I am yours, I am forever yours. Mountain high and valley low, I see out, remind my soul.
said I'm yours, I am yours, and I am yours for all my days, Jesus, I am yours, and I am yours, I am yours for all my days, Jesus, I am. Set me free, I am yours, I am forever yours. In mountain high and valley low, I sing out, remind my soul that I am yours, I am forever yours.
Forever. my King, my Lord. Jesus, Savior, the victory is yours. The victory is yours. You guys can be seated.
Good morning. Good morning, students. this is an awkward transition from the video to us. Good morning, everybody. My name's Clayton. This is Sharie, and we're really excited to be wrapping up the semester with you. I know it's been a long, hard, busy semester. How many of you would say that you have reached just about your limit of physical and mental fatigue? Anybody there? You think you can make it through exams? Yeah. How many of you are at this point in life surviving off of caffeine in the form of coffee or energy drinks? How many of you are just surviving off of naps? How many of you would honestly say, I've been sleeping in class and I'm not ashamed of it? I'm going to confess it right now publicly. I just got said amen on the front row.
At least you're on the front. Maybe I'll stay awake today.
We love being able to come and minister with you and share with you as our ministry partners with Anderson University. Of course, a lot of you know our offices are on campus, and this is where we do our summer camps now, our Crossroads summer camps, and have our staff and our interns with us this morning. Sharie and I have both of our kids with us this morning, Jacob and Joseph, and we're preparing for Christmas too. The only thing is we don't have exams because we've graduated from college, but I definitely and specifically remember what it was like going home for the holidays. And you know, going home when you're in college, it's sort of like purgatory. It's because you're not a teenager anymore, so you're not, you know, living under your mom and dad's rules constantly because you're here. So you're independent. You're getting up when you want to or when you have to sometimes, going to class. You can stay up later and do really important things like play Halo and Destiny and check Facebook and post pictures on Instagram. You can go make a Waffle House run. I don't know if any of you are Christians, but Christians make Waffle House runs on a pretty regular basis. So you're in college and you're sort of independent. You're doing your own thing, but then you go home for Christmas, and it's sort of this weird combination. Like, you're excited to go home for Christmas because, and I mean this with all due respect, and not in any way, shape, or form am I criticizing the food at Anderson University. But I'm not. I'm really not. But when you've eaten anything for like 4.5 months, to go home to your mom's cooking and your grandma's cooking, it's like the second coming of Jesus Christ. And you can have as much of it as you want, and it's comfort food because it's like souffles. Now, that's something you only know if you're in the South.
Or and casseroles.
And you eat a lot of turkey, and turkey contains a chemical called tryptophan. And tryptophan is not what you think. It actually puts you to sleep. Did you know that the more turkey you eat, the more you will fall asleep? Because tryptophan triggers a chemical in your brain that makes you go to sleep. So not only do you go home hungry, you go home tired and you can sleep. You can eat, then you can fall asleep while your mom does your laundry. Isn't that the greatest thing in the whole wide world?
No.
I hear a lot of guys clapping.
Yeah, I think I went home and my mom left all their laundry for me to do when I got there.
Yeah, because your mom's weird. It's true. Well, I want to tell you a quick story. It is true. She is weird, and we all know it. At least we know it. Now you know it. I meant that in the most encouraging kind of way.
What we're trying to say is that it's fun to go home, but sometimes there's expectations, and maybe you're used to being independent in college and, you know, you can make your own decisions, you can do whatever you want. And then there's a weird family dynamic when you go home and all of a sudden there's expectations on you again that you didn't have when you're here. You could make your own decisions here, and then you go home and you walk into a house where everybody loves you and missed you and wants you to do all these things, and maybe you had different ideas of what you wanted to do. Like, I remember one Christmas I came home and I saw boxes of tile in our garage, and grout, and like
a wet saw.
Adhesive in a wet saw, and I realized that we would be tiling our kitchen and living room for the holidays. So you just never know what's going to happen.
Nothing says holiday cheer like forced child labor.
Yes, that's right.
When I went home my freshman year for Christmas, and I know some of you, this is your first time to go home as a college student and not a kid, and that's a really weird transition, I'm just going to tell you. I went home the Christmas break of my freshman year. This was in the 1900s. It was December of 1991, and I had a girlfriend, and she lived in another state. She lived in North Carolina. I lived in South Carolina, and my mom had it in her mind that I would be home. So I had an exam that morning, and I called my mom, and I said, I'm going to try to be home late afternoon, early evening. And she said, well, you know, me and your daddy eat supper at 5:15 on the dot, so you better be here in time for supper. I said, well, Mama, I will try, but I've got an exam, and then I got to pack up, and I've got some other things I've got to take care of. And plus, I was stopping on the way at the Haywood Mall in Greenville, South Carolina, to do some Christmas shopping for my mom and my dad. That was the only time I was going to be able to do it. And so I ended up getting home about 5:45. And you would have thought that the world had come to a close and Donald Trump had just been elected president. It was that bad. It was that bad. It was that bad. My mom met me on the front porch at our house in Fountain Inn. She was standing there. Now, my mom was 5'4", and like a stick of dynamite, she could explode. And she met me on the porch. I had not even turned off my truck. I had 1 foot out of the truck, one hand on the ignition to turn off the engine, and she lit into me. I will never forget this. Where have you been? You know we eat dinner at 5:15, supper. Dinner was what highfalutin city people called it. What my mom called it, supper. We eat supper at 5:15. You know your dad is ready to eat at 5:15. You said you would be here. And I just remember thinking, man, this is not Kansas anymore. This is not the place I left. Things are different now. I was experiencing independence. I was trying to make my own decisions. I had been used to making my own decisions for 4.5 months, and now I'm home. And in my mom's eyes, I was still her little boy. Yeah. I was still that high school kid. And I just remember, losing my temper with her. And this is actually something I'm ashamed of. I remember kind of raising my voice at her a little bit, and I told her this, and I'm embarrassed to say this. This is what you don't do, okay? I said, if this is how it's going to be for the next 3 weeks, I'll get in my truck, and I'll drive out of this driveway right now, and I'll go stay with friends. And I was lashing out at her in my fatigue and in my tired state of mind. The semester had worn me down. I'd been sick. That was the other thing. I'd had a real bad case of bronchitis right before exams because I'd worn myself down. I wasn't eating right. I wasn't sleeping right. And got home, and when my mom said that, it triggered something in me. And now I look back and I realize that I shouldn't have said that. That was the wrong attitude. So just be aware that when you go home and it's awkward and it's hard, it's going to be fun. You're going to enjoy it. You're going to get some gifts. You're going to see your family. You're going to get to hopefully worship with your family at church and be able to eat some good food and just fellowship with the people that love you the most. But I just want to caution you as you go, remember that your mom and dad have not been here with you this semester. And they don't know how tired you are. And they don't know all the struggles that you've had. And they don't know the relationship issues that you've had to struggle with. And they don't know the problems that you've had to face. And they don't know the sleepless nights. And they don't know how you struggled in certain classes. So give them a little bit of grace, and remember this. This is what the Lord reminded me of. The reason why my mom was so upset, and this is, you know, 24 years ago that this happened, and I still remember it, is just because she loved me and she missed me.
Yeah, I think, so we're answering one of your questions that you sent in. How should we deal with the stress of family conflict that tends to rise over the holidays? And I think family conflict comes from two things. and I'm not an expert, but the two things that I've noticed that my family conflict has come from mostly is the fact that we grow and change, and everybody is not together to see you grow and change. So you've had your year here, and maybe you've been home a lot, and maybe you haven't, but you're probably changing as a person, and you will continue to change as a person your whole life. And so I think that we have to be careful to prepare ourselves that when we go home, people are going to remember you for who you were. And they don't mean to. They just knew you when you were little, and then when you were this age, and then you were this age. So sometimes you'll see your aunts and uncles after 5 or 6 years, and they still kind of think of you as when you were in high school, because that's when they spent the most time with you. It's not that they're trying to put you down or not let you be who you are. It's just that's when you had they had the most influence in your life. And so I think we have to prepare ourselves that when we go home, people may just remember us for who we were, and we can't like fast forward and tell them everything, expect them to understand. So those may be expectations. You know, the other thing is expectations. So people may not understand your growth, and then people may also have expectations of you. They've been missing you. They wanted to see you. They want to spend good quality time with you, more than just 2 days. They want to like be around you. They love you. And sometimes those expectations are not things we can always meet. But I think, like Clayton said, you know, not reacting when we come home to an expectation that was unreasonable. Sometimes we almost just have to say, okay, I'm back in the environment where I just need to learn how to honor for just a little while, and be submissive, and learn to love when I don't understand what all this control is. And usually there's control because they love you. And that sounds really weird, but it's just the truth.
And you know, you can get to a point in your life where biblically you don't have to obey your parents anymore. You can graduate beyond that level as a kid. When you go from childhood to adulthood, you don't have to obey your parents anymore. But we never graduate to a place where we don't have to honor them anymore. And so keep that in mind. And as an encouragement to you, there were some questions that the students gave to Greg, and Greg passed on to us about going home for the holidays. And the question that Sharie just mentioned is how should we deal with the stress of family conflict? I want to show you something in the Bible that might surprise you. You're not the only one that dealt with family conflict. Even Jesus, when he was young, dealt with it. There's really only one story in the whole Bible about Jesus when he was a young man. It's Luke chapter 2. You're probably familiar with it. He was in the temple. And the reason why the conflict arose is because Jesus wasn't where his parents wanted him to be. And some of y'all are going to face that when you go home for the holidays. Your mom and dad are going to want you to go out to eat with certain people and go to certain houses and go over to certain people's homes and stay there for a long time. And I can remember some of the family members I had to go visit where, you know, their average age was terminal. And so they kept the furnace on 96 degrees. And I would be in there just praying for lightning to strike the heat unit so that we could, I would literally go outside and take off my jacket. Yeah. And so your parents are going to want you to be places you may not want to be. And they're probably going to want you to do things that you don't want to do. And you would rather be with your friends. And that's the other complicated thing, is that when you go off to college and you go home, not only are you trying to help your parents understand the woman or the man you're becoming, but you've got friends that you went to middle school and high school and church with, and you want to see them. They've changed in the last 6 months, just like you've changed in the last 6 months. Let me read this to you, because even though this is not a story about going home for the holidays, this is a passage of scripture that can help us understand that conflict does arise when you grow up. It says in Luke 2:41, every year Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the feast according to their custom. After the feast was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were unaware of it. And there's a lot of symbolism there. Jesus is 12. He's not considered a young man until he turns 13. That was the Jewish bar mitzvah. In verse 44, it says, thinking he was in their company, his family traveled on for a day. They began looking for him among their relatives and friends. When they didn't find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard Jesus was amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished, and his mother said to him, son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you. You can't fault Mary for being upset and anxious with Jesus. Jesus didn't commit a sin. We know he was sinless, but Jesus didn't meet their expectations. And so that's a lot of times what happens is we grow up. Our parents have expectations of us, and we don't feel like we fit that mold. But it's their love for us. It's their desire for us to have the best and be the best that makes them think that. And I love how Jesus responds to his mother. "Why were you searching for me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my Father's house?" And so who knows how much they knew about Jesus at that point. When I get to heaven, I'd like to see a movie of Jesus' life. I'm pretty sure God was recording it the whole time when he was a kid. I want to see that. I want to see that whole movie. I want to see if Jesus did some crazy miracles. I want to see if Jesus, you know, could. I just want to know what it was like for him as he was growing up. But verse 50 is the one that really stands out. It says, "But his family did not understand what he was saying to them." So even if Jesus was misunderstood by his family, you probably need to prepare yourself as you go home. It's going to be fun. It's going to be great. Don't be defensive. But there will be some things that they may not understand about the journey that you've been on. Here's another question that was sent in by some students. How do we start gospel conversations with family and friends over Christmas break that may not be believers? And Sharie, I know you've got a verse, you've got a passage of scripture that might speak to that. How do we start gospel conversations with family and friends over Christmas break that may not be believers? And I'm sure everybody in this room has got a family member or a friend that may not know the Lord.
Right. I don't know if you have anxiety about going home, or maybe you've been thinking about a family member who you really love, and you're just hoping like the holiday season's going to open up that conversation. My dad, I don't believe that he's a Christian. I'm not really. It's one of those things where it's confusing to me to define that and to figure out whether he is or isn't and all those kinds of things. But I used to always think, Christmas is my opportunity. And it's because I loved him so much, and it's because I love Jesus so much, and I just wanted him to have the love that I had for Jesus. But I think we should be very careful, and the scripture explains this desire in our hearts, this like yearning and this groaning that we have. So in 2 Corinthians 5, I'm not going to read all the way through it, but it says, "For a while we're in this tent, and we groan and we're burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling." So that is what this mortal... what is mortal can be swallowed up by life. And so it says that God has fashioned us for this very purpose. He has given us a spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come. And it says, "Therefore, we are always confident, and we know that as long as we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. We are confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please him, whether that we are at home with the body or away from it." And then it would just keeps going on. It says, "Since then we know what it is to fear the Lord. We try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it's also plain to your conscience. And if you read the next part, it says, "For Christ's love compels us, because we're convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again." And if you keep going on, it talks about how we are new creations and we're in Christ. So let me explain the beginning. The beginning talks about, and you guys probably understand this, we are never going to feel completely at home here on this earth, because we know that we belong somewhere else. And that's what it's saying. Like, right now we're clothed in these bodies. We want to be in heaven. Whether we're scared of dying or not, that's where we're going to feel at home. And so we want our family members to also have that desire, because we want to be there with them. And so for us, it's like we're groaning for them to know the Lord. We're groaning to be with the Lord. We want everyone to come with us. And so the pressure that sometimes in our spirit we carry home to our family, but we have to understand that our family may not be experiencing that same groaning. And so if we come in with, like, you know, swords blazing, and we're like, "You need to know Jesus," and like, it may be a little overwhelming for them, because that's not really what they're thinking about yet. Or maybe we're that light that's trying to show that to them, but we have to be careful how we're shining that light. So let me tell you something that I did that wasn't super awesome. I had a family member, and I just wrote him a letter one time, and I was just like, "I really want you to know the Lord. And, you know, Jesus loves you. I want to know that you're a Christian. I want to know that you love Jesus. I feel like when we have conversations, there's not really a definitive answer. And I want to know this, and I'm willing to sacrifice our relationship in order to show you who Jesus is." But to him, that didn't make sense. Why would I sacrifice my relationship with someone I loved mm-hmm. so that they could know Jesus? So we have to keep in mind that, like, you may understand that. We may understand that the fact that their eternity is settled may be worth anything to you to do to make that happen. But to them, it doesn't make sense that you would say, like, I'm going to tell you anything. I'm going to say anything to you. And if you get offended, I'm okay with that. Like, we have to be super careful how we minister to our family members because there's a lot more emotions involved. So maybe you let that groaning be there. That's a good thing to have, the groaning for your family member to know the Lord. But we have to, like, step it down as much as we can so that we reach them in an effective way instead of turning them off or making them feel like they can't really be themselves around us.
And I'm an evangelist, so I'm the one that's always going to be pushing to share the gospel. But I think a lot of times we feel like, okay, this might be the only time I get to share the gospel with these people.
That pressure motivates us in a wrong way sometimes.
Yeah, and if we think, well, I've got to make this opportunity count because what if Jesus comes back?
Tomorrow.
Or in
an hour.
Yeah, or what if I never get a chance to do this again? One thing that is another practical thing that we can do to share the gospel with family members and friends, it kind of kills two birds with one stone. A lot of your family members, especially your parents, maybe your siblings, they really do want to know what you've been doing since August. And you went home for fall break and you went home for Thanksgiving, but you get, a good three and a half weeks off for Christmas. So one way that you can share the gospel with them is by taking time in a real non-threatening way, in a real informal setting, whether it's going to Starbucks to get a cup of coffee or whether it's going shopping to look for good deals, last minute kind of thing. Take opportunities, even at a dinner table or at the breakfast table or sitting around in the den, and have conversations with your family and where you just tell them all that you've been learning and all that's been changing in you and all the things that God has been teaching you. And what that does is it allows you to connect with them because that's what they want. They want to know what's going on in your life. They want to catch up with you. They've missed you. So one great way to share the gospel is to invite them in and just sit down and have a conversation with them and talk about all your new friends, talk about the things that you've learned, talk about the mistakes you've made, talk about the class that you barely passed and the professor that you love and the one that you're trying to love and you're praying that God will give you the grace to love them and talk about the crazy squirrel that attacks you out on the front lawn and just anything that you can talk about to kind of bring them into your world. And in the midst of that conversation, just talk about the things that God's teaching you. Talk about all the things that you're learning. Talk about your quiet time. Talk about scripture that you've been reading. And that brings me to another question that students sent in to Greg. How do we keep our relationship with Christ growing as we take a break from school and put ourselves in a different environment? How do we stay close to Jesus basically over Christmas? And this is a real challenge because Anderson University is a healthy, wonderful, loving, kind, godly Christian bubble. It is. That's what it's meant to be. That's part of the vision and the mission of a place like this. I went to a Christian school and it was designed. I mean, it wasn't completely isolated from the world, but the blessing of going to a school like this is you get to go to campus worship every week. You can go to FCA. You can go to BSU. You've got professors who are Christians. Some of your classes open with prayer. You know that you can call a professor if you have a need. I know that. This morning, I sent an email to some of my staff because I'm going through a really difficult time right now. And one of the staff members, one of my friends I sent an email to this morning was Dr. Tim McKnight. I emailed him this morning and I said, I need you to pray for me because I'm having a really difficult time. And he emailed me back and he said, anytime, night or day, you call me, I'll be there. He's one of your professors. He's sitting on the second row. That's the special thing about a place like Anderson. I mean, the president's wife cooks 3,000 chocolate chip cookies and gives them to the student body. You're not going to get that any other place. So you go home and nobody's spoon feeding you Bible verses and nobody's opening class in prayer and you're not getting an opportunity to go to campus worship on Wednesdays at 10:10. So what you have to do is you have to keep doing those small things that you know you're supposed to do. And that's how you stay close to Jesus, reading your Bible and praying and being around friends that encourage you.
Yeah, I think practically just making wise choices. So I don't know if you guys struggle with this. Maybe it sounds silly, but I know when I was in college, I just thought when I go back home, the high school influences that I had were not great, but I still wanted to see my friends. And so I think I just had to make wise choices about what I did with those friends when I saw them, because I had this fear that I would end up making choices that I would regret. So going out to lunch with a group of friends like that, it's a safe thing to do. You know, maybe going out to clubbing with them at night would not be, you know what I'm saying? So just finding things that, or going to a movie, like making sure that you're making wise choices with the people that you're around. And so I think that's one tangible thing. The other tangible thing is, oh my goodness, you guys have Skype or like GoToMeeting or whatever. And so you can still talk to the people that you have, that you're in class with, or they're encouraging people that you have here in college. It's not like you have no way to have connection with them or FaceTime or whatever, you know? So you can stay connected to the people here who feed you and encourage you. And then possibly you're going home and you have great influences at home that you can't wait to be around. Maybe you met someone here and they're not that far away from you at home. So I think the key is just communication, you know? Like if you go home and your family wants to be around you and you want to go spend time with friends, just make sure you communicate. They're not gonna hate you because you leave. Just communicate that. You know, Jesus said, didn't you know that I had to be in the temple? Instead of, you know, maybe you go and hang out with friends and you come home and your parents are like, where were you? Well, you didn't tell them that you wanted to go hang out with your friends. And you're like, didn't you know I came home to see my friends? You know, just be careful in how you communicate. Be practical with that, you know? So I think those are some things. And then I just think you have 3 weeks to pour into the Word and not have to read anything else.
Yeah.
You know?
No class, no exams,
like,
no tests.
Grab some book that you've been wanting to read for a long time, and I know you're thinking, that's the last thing I want to do because I read all the time, but maybe get something that like is dumbed down and just have fun with it. Don't feel like you have to learn like something super deep, but find something that will still plug in. Maybe it's just like a daily devotion that takes 3 to 5 minutes a day to read in the morning, and then you spend more time after that, you know, maybe reading a psalm and a proverb. I think a psalm and a proverb every day is something that's easy to do and it feeds you. So that's what I would say.
And as far as like dumbing down, not spiritually speaking dumbing down, but
right.
Like we just took a break. Sharie and I just got away for a few days. I read World War Z.
Yeah. I read Maze Runner.
Yeah. I wanted to read something. I read theology all the time and I never thought I would get into zombie stuff. But I'm a writer and I want to be a better writer. And I'd heard that World War Z was a fast paced, good moving book that really went somewhere. And I read it. I'm not saying you should read it. Maybe you don't. Maybe if you read it, you have nightmares and you're afraid your roommate's going to bite your head off and in the middle of the night. So I'm not telling you to read World War Z. I'm just saying that when you need to rest your brain, get out of the routine that you've been in and do something different. Switch it up a little bit. Two words of caution. Before the band comes back out, two things I would encourage you to make sure that you're prepared for is, number one, don't go home and retreat into your room and spend your entire Christmas break on your phone.
Or Netflix.
And I was going to say that too. Don't veg out on Netflix. Yeah.
I mean, it's okay. Some binging is, I totally get it. But once you get into that, your brain just can't get out of it. It's like that's what you feel like you need the most, and it's not what you need the most. Maybe you need to take a walk with your family in the park. We always take a family thing. Everybody feasts on like food all day, and then we're like, oh, let's get out. And so we'll just take a walk around the neighborhood. It's nothing huge or amazing, but maybe a marathon. Maybe your town is running a marathon. Those are good things to do with family or friends.
A marathon, 26.2 miles.
Oh, I meant like a 5K.
Like a turkey trot.
Just do a marathon, you know?
You'll rest real well after that in the hospital.
Or you could do a marathon in the mall. You know what I'm saying? Like,
like the senior citizens that just walk in circles.
Like go at 5 a.m. and you can witness to old people there before they die. I'm just
That's
kidding.
A great way to
That's
share the
really
gospel.
Mean. That's how you can
during the holidays.
Plug into your faith over the holidays.
I don't know any malls that are open at 5 a.m., but if you can find one, I bet there'll be some really sweet old people there. One other thing I'll caution you with is when you go home, it's so easy to get back into old habits, whether they're good or bad. One thing that I noticed when I was in college is that so many of my friends would go home and they would hook up with old flames.
Yeah.
Please be cautious about that because your emotions are going to be sort of, the guard will be down on your emotions, and you just got to be careful that you're not searching for identity and intimacy with somebody just because you know they'll give it to you. Mm-hmm. It's a lot easier to go back to old relationships that you're familiar with, even if they're not godly and even if there's no commitment there. But be careful that you guard your heart, Proverbs 4:23, and that you guard their heart. So a lot of us will have ex-boyfriends or ex-girlfriends, or, you know, in our culture today, they don't even have to be an ex-boyfriend or an ex-girlfriend, just somebody that you went out with or kissed or made out with no commitment. And that can lead to dangerous places. So be careful that you guard that too, because it's real easy now that you feel like I've got a little bit of independence, I can kind of do this, to make decisions that you might regret. So be careful with that as well.
This might be something super fun to do with a younger, say like you have a cousin or a friend that you want to hang out with. I'm thinking about Brian Kaysen here. He's like Instagram like awesomeness, and he'll like hook up with Instagram people when he goes to a town. Not hook up like in a hookup relationship type way, but he'll like
connect
with them, and they'll go and take pictures of the city or surrounding areas, and like they just take pictures together. And that sounds maybe kind of silly, but I love it. I love that you walk away from that with this creative outflow that you got to do with a friend. And so maybe there's a family member that you can go do that with, like hang out in the city and take pictures of each other, or tell them to take a picture of you because you want a picture of yourself. I mean, selfies are awesome. So, except that's not really a selfie. It's kind of like someone else takes your selfie picture. I don't know what that's considered.
So picture of yourself.
Yeah, picture of yourself. So anyway, that's like a fun thing to do. And as far as the hookup thing, be careful also. If you're long distance dating, I just know that when Clayton and I were dating, we had a period of long distance. And then sometimes when he would go out of town for a few days, when he came back in town, that was the strategic time to be careful physically, because you just haven't seen each other. And so sometimes that's just the time that you're like, oh, yay, we finally get to be together. And you may make mistakes that you don't want to make. In that time. So be aware that you could be weak in that like come back together moment. And it doesn't mean that person's evil or that your relationship is wrong. It just means you need to be more careful and prepare for that.
We want to pray over you. The band is going to come back out now and lead us in one final song. And we're going to pray over you as you prepare for exams, to finish strong, to make it to the finish line, and to go home and eat some good food and get some good sleep and see people you love. Mm-hmm. Lord, I want to pray for this student body here at Anderson University today. I pray that they would be able to go home knowing that you are their Lord, knowing that you have given them the grace that they need to be strong, and that even when they're weak, your strength is made perfect in their weakness. I pray that they would not forsake or forget their own personal prayer life, their own devotional life, that they would open up the Word every day to feast on your grace. I pray that they would worship, and the music that they listen to, and even when they're alone in the car, I pray that they would sing. Pray they would be in church, that they would sit there with the community of faith to worship you corporately and to hear a word from you. And I pray, God, that you would help them to be refreshed and renewed in their hearts and their bodies and their spirits as they travel home. And I pray that you would bless their time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Will you guys stand with us?
Beyond all
thank you for that love, and we thank you that we can be a part of that, and that you give us that power to love on our families and love on our friends. And I pray that you would help us remember that. And it's in your name I pray. Amen. You guys are dismissed.
Mistletoe.